Good evening, everyone. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you to this special webinar, which is about succeeding in the post-COVID career scenario. It is a matter of great honor that I get to introduce our panel of luminaries. I'll start with Dr. Amrita Dass, who needs no introduction. She is the pioneer of career counseling and guidance services in India. Back when she started the Institute for Career Studies in 1985, these fields were not heard of in the country. Today, under her leadership, the Institute has a strong presence, not just in India, but also in several other countries. Next on the panel is Ms. Kiran Kanjani. She is Director Southeast Asia and a Senior Career Counselor at ICS. Ms. Kanjani has over 16 years of experience in career counseling. Right now, she's in Bangkok, Thailand, where she's also serving as a consultant to several schools and educational agencies. Next, let me introduce Dr. Monika Dass, who is a very senior psychologist and a senior career counselor at ICS. Dr. Dass is a chartered psychologist and chartered scientist of the British Psychological Society, the UK. She also has an MSc in organizational psychology from the University of Manchester. Apart from rich experience in psychology, she brings to the table decades of experience in career counseling, in management, education, and voluntary service. Next, let me introduce Ms. Anuja Kumar. Ms. Anuja Kumar is Director, Eastern Region, and also a Senior Career Counselor at ICS. She has over two decades of experience in career counseling, in personal effectiveness, soft skills training, psychology, and organizational development. Welcome, panelists. I'm sure this session is going to be very enriching, all about knowledge sharing and highly interactive.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanchita.
Thank you so
much. Thank you so much.
A warm welcome to each one of you to this webinar today. I'm so happy that students, parents, teachers, and also principals have joined from all over the country, some from Dubai, Middle East, that is, and Bangladesh, Thailand are also in our midst. Today, May 9th, is ICS Career Counselors Day. And to begin with, I'd like to salute ICS Career Counselors and career counselors in all schools and colleges who make a difference. It is not telescopes that discover stars. It is career counselors who actually facilitate in discovering the star in you, the hero or heroine in you. So very happy Career Counselors Day today. We'll now start with our presentation, wherein I'm going to be talking about post-COVID specializations. And in today's session, we'll answer a lot of questions which we have received, and we'll also have some wonderful inputs from our panelists. We will answer questions which we receive, we'll open it to the house, and we'll try and cover an entire spectrum. So I request all of you to be present till the last so that you get everything that we have to give you to help you succeed in your mission in life. So a few years ago, all of us embarked on the artificial intelligence driven fourth industrial revolution. It came very quickly, unexpectedly. The first industrial revolution was all about steam and steam engines. Second, about electricity and about mass production, assembly line production. The third industrial revolution is when most of you were born. And that was about information technology, the WWW, which I refer to not so much as a World Wide Web, but whatever, wherever, wherever. And we see it happening so much more. And that has been boosted by AI now to bring in the fourth industrial revolution. Now, the prediction a few years ago was that between 2012 and 2022, we would witness the same quantum of changes that the world witnessed in 100 years. However, COVID-19 has further accelerated the pace of change, impacting every sphere of our lives. the choices we make now about school, about college, university careers will have an impact of COVID and its aftermath. It's very, very tragic how thousands have lost their lives and thousands have lost their livelihood. At the same time, while we commiserate with them, let us see opportunity in adversity. So it's important to see how can we make the most of the situation that we are going through now, which is unprecedented. Yes, COVID has caused havoc in our lives. Can we now do something to make it a very positive future for ourselves? Because there is opportunity and we see some of it. For instance, all of us are excited about the environment rejuvenation. Fresh air that we are breathing is going to have a positive impact on our health. Innovations. Very quickly, people are innovating not only new vaccines, but also masks and all kinds of AI tools to make learning easier. So the learning curve has gone up. We are reimagining and reinventing our future. Another very positive development has been the caring and sharing across the world of free resources, such as courses and books and entertainment and cultural enrichment, reaching the unreached. We have learned to be more patient, more careful, and more agile in responding quickly to the challenges, in adapting to them. So the first message I give you is that today it's not just going to be about the survival of the fittest, but the survival of the fittest and the quickest. So that's a very important aspect that we need to bring into our lives. And I think we have already learned the lesson. Let's move from here. I believe, and all of us at ICS believe in the power of now. And the power of now is all about students of today being leaders, not of tomorrow, but leaders of today. Being experts in their special fields, not of tomorrow, but of today. And we have the opportunities to be able to leverage our talent in unique ways, showcase it, and become that star, that trailblazer now. I'll give you a few examples. The first person on the screen is a young boy called Sameh. He's from Bangalore. And recently, he won an award of 2.9 crores in San Francisco in an international competition, where he made a brilliant presentation on our circadian rhythm, our body rhythm, and how we react differently to different times of the day. Next to him is Shapat Bharadwaj, a grade 12 student who's a shooting champion, who has been part of the world team for India. And he recently created an app on games, on sports. Angad Daryani is a student right here to my left below from Mumbai who developed a virtual e-reader for visually handicapped. On the top right, we have Arshdeep Singh, a wildlife photographer, 2018. He got that award. Then Sarah Rose in the center, 9 years old, who co-authored her first book with a very renowned author called Paro Anand. And that book is called A Very Naughty Dragon. Samaira, who is the next one there, Mehta, 10 years old, is a founder CEO of Coda Bunnies. And she's developed a game to teach young children coding. Anand Krishna Mishra is a young teacher who started a school at the age of 11. So before he goes to school, which is City Montessori School in Lucknow, he goes to teach these kids who are not in school, and he's doing it with passion. So students, I want you to reflect. I want you to think how you can be that writer, that artist, the designer, the teacher, inventor, entrepreneur, sports person, filmmaker of today? How can you be that leader of today, that philanthropist of today, who's going to make a difference? So this is our thought for you, and I'd like you to consider it and jot down your thoughts and ideas and use technology to leverage it. This again is a very important approach to decision-making, where your talents and the needs of the world converge, where talents and needs of the world match, lie your opportunity for success. So if you look at this diagram, it brings three universes together. The first one is recognizing what you're great at, what your talents are, aptitudes are, then what you love to do, what you enjoy doing. And then you combine them to see what does the world need. And then fine-tune your aptitudes and your talents with your passion to make a career out of it and fit it in with what the world needs. And there are a universe of opportunities for you, because that is what is going to give you your dream job. That is what's going to give you meaning in life, fulfillment. So the questions you need to ask at every stage are, who am I? Where am I? Where do I want to be? How do I get there? And these are the kinds of questions we receive all the time. And we would like to share with you the first movie that ICS launched earlier today called Your Choice Matters. So let's see that, because it'll give you many, many thoughts and ideas and messages.
And you're wasting your time on all this?
What's wrong with that?
You are capable of much more, Alia.
I want to be a designer.
Engineering is the thing for you.
Not art.
Engineering is the thing for you.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, children. Sit down. Alia, are you okay? You're looking upset. Okay. Boys, why are you not in uniform? Sit down. Okay, children, I have your maths papers. Let's see how you've done. Alia, you have the highest in maths. Congratulations. Your parents must be so proud. I hope you go in for engineering. And Mars, what is this? Such a poor performance. Really, I hope you know the board exam is just around the corner.
Hey guys, how are you?
Hi.
Hey, what's wrong? Why are you so sad? Aren't you happy you scored the highest marks? You can get into any college. Why aren't you happy?
I don't know, yaar. I'm so confused.
What? You're disappointed because you missed one mark? Such a snob, Alia.
Please, it's not that. I mean, fine, I got great marks, but I don't know if I really want to go for engineering or not.
Then don't go. Do what you want. You're pretty amazing at design. Why don't you go for that?
Dude, she's pretty amazing at science too. She can get into any college and go for anything. I don't know if I'll get what I want or not.
Yeah, right. Like, why did I even take science if I didn't want to go for engineering?
You guys remember what our career counselor said?
Yeah, she said that everyone who loves science doesn't need to go for engineering.
And she also said that today there are so many career options, so you can make your passion your profession.
And yeah, you can always talk to your parents about it.
My parents, they would never agree to it.
Let her be, na guys. It's her choice. By the way, did you guys see that Elon Musk interview?
That
is amazing.
Remote pan, on pan,
afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Alia, it's your work?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, so good.
It's very beautiful.
Thank you so much.
Very nice.
Keep it up.
Hey, we're going to look for some engineering books. You want to come along? Hey.
That's wonderful. We must celebrate. I'm so proud of you, Beta.
Thanks.
Congratulations.
Thanks, Papa. Actually, the application.
Which application?
For engineering.
Oh, I've done that. The receipt is on your table.
Oh, thanks, Papa.
You paid already?
Yes. I filled the application form and paid the fees.
Wow. Way before the deadline.
I'm so glad you went to the Institute for Career Studies for expert advice.
Mom, Pa, you did it. It's design, not engineering. I'm going to India's first design university. It's my dream come true. Thank you so much, Pa. Thank you so much, Mom.
It's for you, Beta. Live your dream.
Thank you so much.
Isn't this what you wanted?
Yes, Pa.
Wanting to surprise you. I think it's worked.
Yes, it has.
Follow your dream, Beta. You know, this time must be very stressful. Peer pressure, our expectations must be stressing you out. But remember, we are there for you, no matter what you choose. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Hey Alia,
what's up? You look happy today.
You won't believe what happened.
What? Did you see that interview?
He's awesome, right?
Arre, no, yaar. You know my parents. They got me registered for the Anand National University Ahmedabad's entrance exam.
What?
My parents, I thought they wanted me to go for engineering. And now, it's design.
You can always go for product designing after engineering, right?
No, yaar. It's not the same thing.
Yeah, congratulations. And I was thinking that we'll go to the same engineering college.
Don't worry. I'll do your company's branding, okay? Guys, by the way, I was thinking that we misunderstand our parents so much. All they need is that we be free with them and share our thoughts. Right, guys?
Yes, you're right. They should see our drive and determination. Hey, do you guys think they'll let me become a professional gamer?
Well, if you are sure that you want to pursue that as your career, you can always talk to your parents about that.
Yeah. Now I am also sure. I don't want to be a lawyer like my father. I want you a psychologist.
You love music and psychology, right? So you can go for music therapy just like my cousin Shreya.
Yeah, you can be the greatest, you can be the best, you can be the King Kong.
palm banging on your chest. You could beat the world, you could beat the war. You could talk to God, go banging on his door. You can throw your hands up, you can beat the clock. Yeah. You can move a mountain, you can break rocks. You could be a master, don't wait for luck. Dedicate yourself and you go find yourself.
Standing in the hall of fame.
So I hope you enjoyed that brief film and you got a lot of messages from it. Remember, it's important to actually believe in yourself, to believe in your goal. So let's see the next slide, which will bring out the points to remember. So the first point I want all of us to remember is that there are no ideal careers, only ideal choices. Too far, we have been influenced by misconceptions. Misconceptions when it comes to choices like science, commerce, art. Science is given the first place. Then when it comes to careers, everybody just thinks in terms of engineering and medicine, and then perhaps law or management. There are infinite options today, students. You're such a lucky generation. So just remember to fine-tune the choices to your unique frequency, your aptitudes, your interests, what you love doing, your aspirations. And at this stage, because most of you are in grades 10, 11, and 12, and some have just passed out from 12, identify the right course at the right campus. And what has happened here is that education today is no longer a seller's market. It's a buyer's market, which means that there are more seats in quality institutions than students. So the issue is not that you're studying in a great campus. The issue is that you are in a renowned campus, a branded campus, but are you studying what you should be studying? So you may be at, for example, St. Stephen's College, and you may be studying economics. Should you have been doing architecture somewhere else? That is the issue. A great campus which is known for your course. Don't compromise on that. Thereafter, start planning on your future and make your passion your profession. Again, it is possible today. And there are many pathways that can lead you to your goal. Remember that success comes when opportunities meet with preparation. Find out what it would require for you to reach your goal. The subjects, the knowledge, the skills, the attitude, the training, the experience. Just pick it all up. So dream big, act now. As Walt Disney said, if you can dream it, you can do it. But I believe between dreaming and doing, it's important to wake up. So we move to the next one. And I want us to think of this, that for meaning in life, what is very, very important is mental and physical wellness. Optimal performance cannot happen without a healthy body and a healthy mind. And if we have both, we then get to realize our choices successfully, which brings us great happiness, which brings us meaning in life. So the unprecedented COVID lockdown, apart from its huge impact on every aspect of life, is the world's biggest psychological experiment. Here, both capability and copability are required. And we have two eminent ICS psychologists and career counselors, Dr. Monika Dass and Ms. Anuja Kumar, to suggest some guidelines. So over to you, Dr. Monika Dass.
Thank you, Dr. Dass. I just wanted to mention that during this very traumatic, but yet very fruitful time in our lives, there's so much we can do in terms of building up our mental health. The first point I'd like to emphasize is exercise. Now, gyms are closed. It doesn't really matter. You've got yoga, aerobics, walking, workouts, dancing, etc. You can use videos. Exercise is the first thing you need to really keep in mind. The second guideline I'd like to give you is a very, very good night's sleep. We need 7 to 8 hours. Please try and get it every night if you can. The third one, try and reduce screen time if you can. I know we spend a lot of time either on Netflix these days or perhaps with your computer on online courses, but try and break it up so that every 2 hours you're doing something different and you're not on the screen all the time. A fourth one I'd like to emphasize to you is to have a structured day. This is extremely important. You need to figure out your time to do your studies, so 2 or 3 hours over that. Spend a couple of hours on your hobbies, a few hours with the family, and come back to your work if you need to later in the day. So have a kind of a routine which gives you a sense of fulfillment. The next activity I'd like you to look at is something called social activity, where you keep in touch with your friends, not just your close friends, not just your best friends, but people whom you have not met for a long time, you've not been in touch with. Reach out to them. You have no idea how much of happiness you're going to be able to give them if you do reach out. I know many of you are into meditation, and there's something else called mindfulness. These are just very important examples of helping you keep focused in your daily life. And I'd like you to get into it. So look up online for things, simple meditation, nothing complicated. Nobody's asking you to spend half an hour, just a couple of minutes every day. And the seventh and most important thing is building good relationships with your family. We are with each other right now 24/7. We're not used to it. None of us are. So you need to understand where your parents are coming from, your grandparents, and other extended family members. Reach out to your grandparents. They're a treasure trove. They've got so many stories to tell you. Reach out to them. So these are the 7 points I'd like to make right now. And in case Dr. Dass would like me to come in a little later, I'm very happy to do that. Thank you
so much. That was so useful. I got some tips too about planning my day better. I need to do that because I was beginning to get stressed out. So thank you for that. I would also like to emphasize one point that Dr. Monika Dass made, and that's a very important point about relationships. So there was a Harvard study, and I'd like you all to see it. And this Harvard study was the longest study ever conducted. You'd find it on YouTube, 70 years over the same group of people, tracking them and their families to find out what made people healthy, successful, fulfilled, and happy. And the conclusion was amazing, but not difficult to accept. It's there, you know, but we tend to overlook it. The conclusion was that what makes us happy, healthy, successful, fulfilled is caring, nurturing, loving relationships with our family members, with our friends, with people in our community, and people who are our colleagues. So I think if we could just be mindful about this fact, we would find that our lives would be so much more enriched, and we will be more positive in our approach to what we take up. Thank you so much, Dr. Dass. Over to you, Mrs. Anuja Kumar.
Thank you so much. And it's so nice to be in the midst of 565 people who are eager to cross over the COVID. And what Dr. Dass just mentioned, that lockdown is the world's biggest psychological experiment. But in my view, it is also the lockdown is providing us several keys. It's got keys which nobody till now had ever even thought about. For instance, now students are getting you, you all are getting used to a hybrid way of learning. So not just online classes, but eventually you will be facing the offline classes. I mean, nobody is going to take away the classrooms from us. So flexibility is the key. Ability to adapt to the change is the key. And I would recommend, and that is exactly what I'm doing currently under lockdown, is to, this is a pause that has been given to us by nature. Can I observe? Can I observe what is happening around me? Just with a little bit of detachment and just see what is happening around me. And therein the solutions for future would be. Because the more we understand how lockdown has impacted our lives, societies, economies, businesses, I think you people are at the helm, the youngsters are at the helm to come up with innovative solutions. That how do we contribute in preparing for a pandemic-proof business solution, a pandemic-proof education system, a pandemic-proof XYZ? So I think these are green shoot times for us. And if we keep ourselves agile, if we keep ourselves excited, I think sky is the limit for each one of us. And I will be happy to take more questions as we go along.
Thank you so much, Mr. Kumar. You gave us wonderful tips of how we can find newer opportunities and develop certain skills. I think we then recognize that we have really immense opportunity in our midst. So what we'll do is, we can take up a few questions now. If we have anyone who's put out a question, we could take some questions. Are any questions out so far?
So one question is there, how to find our passion? We enjoy playing, watching TV and reading.
So how to find your passion if you enjoy playing and watching TV?
Yeah.
I think when you talk about passion, we have to see passion in terms of hobbies and passion in terms of careers and see how we can bring it together. So if you love reading, you enjoy reading, there are a lot of careers which would require you to read. For example, if you go into media-related fields, if you go in for research, if you go into creative writing, you'll have to read a lot. So you could bring in these aspects into your career and also look for careers which relate to these fields and then practice to make perfect and take the necessary courses. That is what I would suggest. So let's move on now. I'm going to talk about how to make choices after 12th about subjects and campuses. This is going to be very, very useful in terms of guiding you to a strategy. So I talked about the right course at the right campus. You have three broad possibilities. The first one is, if you're academically oriented, you love a subject, you enjoy studying business studies or accounts or maths or economics or history, geography, physics, chemistry, biology, any of this. If you love studying that, it is advisable to do your undergraduate studies in an academic field, unless you're moving for engineering or medicine, wherein you will be taught these things. For all other fields, be it a five-year law course, or be it professional courses like management, like media, don't jump into a professional course immediately. Look at the possibility of doing a BA or BSc or BCom in the subject of your choice. What will happen after that? You'll have two more options. One would be to continue with that field, do your master's, MA, MSc, MCom, become a specialist. And a lot of jobs are there for people who have deep knowledge of their subject. If you want to go on to a research track, you can think of a PhD. Now, after your BA, BSc, BCom, if you decide, I've had enough of that subject, I enjoyed studying it, but now I want to do something else. So what you could do then is to move to a professional program. You could do an MBA, that is management. You can go in for media. you can mass communication, do a 3-year law course, public relations. There would be so much more for you in terms of then looking at a professional program right after you do this. If you don't want an academic course and you want to go straight for a professional course, then you can do your engineering, medicine, a BBA program, hotel management, media studies, social work, architecture. So there are a lot of opportunities for you after plus two to go for a professional course. You've got to be pretty clear about what that course has to be. And then you have more options after undergraduations. There are combinations as well. So that is the beauty of the multiple options you have today, the multiple places from where you can take up courses online as well as on campus. For example, a very interesting combination of English, psychology, and journalism. Christ has it, Bangalore University has it. Economics, sociology, and industrial relations. Performing arts, English, and psychology. Economics, media studies, political science. BA with Bachelors of Education, BA LLB, BSc LLB, BCom LLB. So there are a lot of combinations. Supposing you want to go for acting, and acting is not something where you can get an immediate breakthrough, but you're passionate about acting. So take up a course of your choice, academic or professional, and take up classes in acting. Similarly, if it's performing arts other than acting, like dance and singing, or it's sports, photography, take up courses, develop that talent, and see when it's possible for you to just find a niche for yourself which taps your talent to the fullest. So there are many options. Choose carefully. Don't have to worry about openings. Yeah, as I said, more seats than students in good quality campuses. Also, supposing there are two things you want to do, history and geography, but you're not getting it anywhere as a combination, you could look at doing perhaps geography or history at a great campus where you get admission, and do the other subject from an online program from any good university or an open university like IGNU. So students, you can mix and match, and you can see how, with proper time management, you can bring in the different building blocks that relate to you.
There are many more questions.
Yes, let's pick them up.
So there's one about COVID-19 pandemic. Aditya yes. Chaudhary asks, ma'am, will the job opportunities be affected due to COVID-19 pandemic?
Job opportunities have been affected in the near future. For example, people who are in the hospitality sector, in the travel and tourism sector, are without jobs. Entrepreneurs are without jobs. Many factories have shut down. So in the near future, immediate future, jobs have been affected. And that is why it's important to be agile and to think like an entrepreneur. So the new term which is now being used is serial entrepreneurship. Move from one thing to another, or a gig economy, where your talent is utilized by companies and organizations across the board. For example, if you're great at digital marketing, many companies would want you to do digital marketing for them, or great at developing a website or an app, or at content writing. You will have plenty of opportunities. So it's essential to look at where the opportunities lie, where you can have a flow of income, and quickly move to that.
There's a question by Pragya. What will be the effect on technology integration in schools with respect to the post-COVID scenario?
So what has happened is that very quickly schools have moved from education 2.0, which was chalk and talk, to education 4.0. where they're using a blended learning approach. They're using technology to teach in very interesting ways, and students are enjoying it. What they're missing is the company of friends. being out in the school, interacting with friends, they're missing that because you're confined to the four walls of your home. But the impact is going to be a far more dynamic teaching learning process because every teacher now has been compelled to upgrade the teaching and learning process. Necessity is a mother of invention, and it's going to get better and better. And students, you will have an important role in designing the various class sessions using technology.
Anushka Malik says, do you think becoming an actor is an unreal dream? How should I work towards it?
No dream is unreal. You've got to believe in it. Because if it's close to your heart, if it's something that you're passionate about, if it is the purpose of your life, you can make it happen. So I'll give you an example of a student at Dune School, Ashish Kapoor. It was his dream to be an actor, and he didn't come from an actor's family. He took a lot of roles in the school plays. So when he went in to do his bachelor's, he went to Mumbai, studied at Jai Hind. He studied economics and English at Jai Hind. But alongside, he trained at the Actor Prepares. He learned the art and science of acting. He didn't get an immediate breakthrough. And then he had his first break in a movie, after which very recently he has acted in The Great Indian Escape. So he's had a number of good films, also Bollywood ones. And I just want you to know that his first film was Kurban, Ashish's, and he's never looked back. So you need to balance your academics with the requisite training, showcase your talent, practice, and look out for opportunities and take them very quickly as you find them. So I say where your talents and the needs of the world match, lie in opportunity, grab the opportunity, be alert. And students, I want to assure you all your questions will be answered following our last webinar on the 25th of April. We had over 100 questions. All the students got individual answers. So don't worry if you don't answer it now, because of paucity of time, keep them coming, you'll receive a response. I now want to give you some good news. There are a lot of careers available from all subjects. You don't need any subject combination or stream to go into these careers, which I'm going to show you. But what I want you to know is there will be a digital transformation in each career field. And that's been expedited because of the COVID scenario. So if, for example, in advertising and corporate communication, you'll have much more of digital media, art and design, UI, UX, accountancy, analytics, banking, finance, much more of e-banking, e-finance. In business management, there'll be much more of analytics, career guidance online. Civil services will go in for e-governance majorly. Computers and IT will have many specializations for people from all subject backgrounds. And the good news is, if you do not do physics, chemistry, math, computer science, you can take up a lot of certified courses from Microsoft and become competent as a computer engineer, as a coder. It's gone beyond groups of subjects. A lot depends on how you develop your talent. So there's the education field, there's hospitality, travel and tourism. Hospitality sector for a while will witness a setback. Travel will now to a great extent be restricted. So you'll have to look at alternatives. If you're into the field of, let us say, culinary art, you could actually become a specialist chef and then provide your speciality to people through the various digital marketing sites like Swiggy. I came across something very interesting. just a few days ago, just to give you an idea in this travel segment. I received an app, and the app was all about, you can't move anywhere, click this button, travel any country, listen to the music of the country. So you click it on and you're almost like driving through the streets of London, of Madrid, of Cape Town and Singapore, Tokyo. So see, there's a lot of innovation that you can do in each field, which will be of a digital nature. Insurance, law, media, psychology related fields are going to be very, very important because of its connect with artificial intelligence. Performing arts, social work, sports. If you're into sports, look at sports media, sports psychology, sports medicine, sports management. So there are a lot of possibilities for you, and don't hesitate to just decide what matches with you, what is the best career fit, and just go for it. Because if you do what you enjoy doing and you train yourself for it, you will excel. And when you excel in it, you enjoy, you deliver excellence. And that is what makes you relevant. That is what makes you very much in demand as a professional in that field. This is exciting. There were career specializations that did not exist yesterday, like UI, UX. Who heard of it? AI, machine learning, robotics, wellness specialists, digital marketing, forensic accounting, you know, in law, genetics and cyber. I mean, there's so much today that we'd never heard about. Similarly, there are many new combinations today that did not exist yesterday. Let's look at some of those subject combinations. And I'd like you to look at interdisciplinary subjects as you make your choices. So you have earth sciences. Post-COVID, this is going to be one of the most important. People with geography, geology, chemistry, biology, economics, environmental science can go into a specializations here. Psychobiology, studying psychology and biology together will lead to specializations like neurosciences, cognitive sciences, all about a healthy body and a healthy mind. And fortunately, schools have brought this as a specialization within the group of arts and commerce subjects. Data analytics is not confined to maths and science. Whether you are in the hospitality sector, the educational sector, management, media, it's very important. So, as you have the time now, take up a short course on data analytics, which is not difficult. It's available on online platforms, very often free, on, let us say, Udemy or Coursera. You got short courses of data analytics, it will give you an edge. If you bring economics together with psychology, you have a new field of behavioral economics and behavioral finance. Because, for example, the stock markets are influenced by human behavior, the ups and the downs. Similarly, the marketplace. So this is a very, very important field. Another fascinating field is cleodynamics, a combination of history, maths, and statistics and computer science. So history is about understanding the past to be able to interpret the present and predict the future. In a very VUCA world, which is volatile, uncertain, complex, ambiguous, if you apply mathematical formulae, you will be able to predict with greater accuracy. So there's going to be a huge demand for this field where you bring history, math, statistics together. Environmental science and design is another field. And I would like you to think of all these possibilities. So just like today, we have specializations that did not exist yesterday. Students, 60% of the future jobs do not exist today. You need to track the changes. You need to identify what subjects you like and go in for specializations in those and related areas. You've got to be lifelong learners today, because all of you will have a minimum of 5 different careers in your life. So it's going to be a life of great exploration, of adventure, and you can really enjoy it if you chart your course very, very carefully and with a lot of current knowledge and information. This is a fascinating development. Liberal arts shine in the age of artificial intelligence. Liberal arts is an interdisciplinary field where you can take up a number of subjects, explore them, and you have projects and research work where you express your views, do collaborative work. So the news is that a liberal arts graduate is a tech company's hottest ticket. So all tech companies are hiring liberal arts graduates because they are thought leaders, they are ideators, they are design thinkers, and they've got language. So this is important. So what exactly is liberal arts? Let's quickly look at it. As I said, a wide range of interdisciplinary courses across natural science, social science, humanities, and arts. It's a misconception that liberal arts is only about humanities. You can, for example, take up biology with psychology, math with literature. So this is in contrast to typically vocational, professional, or technical courses, which of course are also useful. Now this results in well-rounded students with a knowledge of a wide range of subjects and mastery over one or two, higher order thinking skills, design thinking, creativity, and acquisition of a number of employability skills like excellent communication skills, team building, leadership, and so on. Now this is very, very, very important, the post-COVID specializations. And this is what you need to concentrate on, because here is the world of work, the universe of careers that you will be embarking on after your graduate studies. Digital transformations in all career fields with a hybrid model of real and virtual worlds. Serial entrepreneurship, where you quickly switch tracks depending on the trends. Environmental sciences and management, ecology, sustainable development expertise. This will be needed. Smart villages. We've talked about smart cities. Smart villages are our future for sustainable development and global orientation. Global orientation being thinking locally, acting globally, and vice versa. Organic farming. Students, all the high touch careers where you deal with people like counselors, caregivers, wellness specialists, teachers, trainers will do fabulously. Scientific research, there'll be newer horizons. So think about it. If you love a particular subject in science, don't just think of going in for engineering and medicine unless you really want to. Think of moving into that field of science like physics or chemistry or biology or mathematics and move ahead in specializations. A very new field which doesn't have many courses on offer right now is disaster management. And disaster management would teach us how to do pre-disaster, disaster and post-disaster management, particularly in the light of unprecedented attacks like COVID. Analytics I've talked about, computer science and IT innovations. There'll be newer specializations here. Anyone who's interested, you will never look back. There'll be a lot of new fields. Right now, everybody is talking about robotics and machine learning and artificial intelligence. It's going to be much more. It's going to be a different level of intuitive awareness, which we'll have to build our software with. 3D and 4D. So here we come to a very important message, dear students. Specialization in one field is not good enough for future jobs. Educationists and employers have made this prediction. keep in mind all the building blocks closely related to your interests and aptitudes and plan out how you're going to develop your competencies in these. What we're going to take up now is studies in India and studies abroad. So for studies in India, you have excellent campuses. And as I said, there's no shortage of seats. You can make a choice and decide which ones are going to be your dream campus. So it's a rewarding educational experience. A lot of you who were planning on only studying abroad may have to keep India as an option because you don't know when you will be able to travel abroad. I was talking to doctors. I've been doing it for the last few weeks. And they say that there's no certainty till a vaccination is developed. So we cannot take anything for granted, and we've got to have fallback options. So India has great campuses, wonderful teaching, and I think we need to look at this as an option. And I'll tell you what's happening in terms of admission very quickly. So apply to all, and if you've got extracurricular activities and sports at a national level, you can apply with that background. So now let's just look at the post-COVID scenario with regard to campuses. First important point is the registration process for all undergraduate and postgraduate admissions have been put on hold, which means that this will open later. Some have started admission. For instance, Christ University has started. Asian Academy of Film and Television has started. Manipal University's Welcome Group Hotel Management has started. Now, the problem is some have started and some will start later. You may not get your dream campus now. Should you or should you not pay your fees? If the university is asking for full fees, and it's not your dream campus, it's number 7 or 8 on your list, please do not pay full fees. I can guarantee you seats will be available. Wait for other admissions to happen. Don't rush into it. Don't let people capitalize on the fear psychosis, because everybody is wanting to make sure that they're financially strong. The second thing I want you to know is that all last dates for competitive exams have been extended, and competitive exam last dates have been extended. So that gives you more time to prepare. Use this to your best advantage. Prepare well. Most of these entrance exams have objective type questions on reasoning, which is not taught in school. Get books like Edgar Thorpe's Mental Ability. Try and go through it. So General Mental Ability by Edgar Thorpe is excellent for reasoning. So English objective type questions on comprehension, vocabulary, usage, numerical ability, general knowledge. Prepare now, because normally these entrance exams would have happened right after your board exams. Now you've had time to prepare. Prepare well, you will make it. So the best thing that has happened is that extensions, more time. We have received questions. Will the entire university program be compressed? Will it be impacted? No. They'll start later. But though they start later, they will complete the course. So instead of July, most of them are now going to open on the 1st of September. It doesn't matter. Make the best use of this time. Take up courses like analytics, digital marketing, hobby courses, writing courses, speaking courses, personality development. It's going to add huge value to your profile. So we'll now come to the next important area, and I'll request my colleague, Kiran Kanjani, who's based in Bangkok, to talk to you about the studies abroad scenario. And she's going to give you all the very latest information. So studies abroad. Over to you, Kiran.
Hello, everyone. I hope you all can hear me.
Yes, very clearly.
It is such a lovely session. Seeing so many participants and a lot of queries on different issues, would be very excited to answer them. So we quickly go through this studies abroad thing. I saw a lot of questions are also coming in, just popping in, whether we should go now in this scenario to study abroad or not. So a very important aspect is, have you got the offers? If you have got any offer from the university, just rethink about it. You really want to go this year or you want to have a deferral? Or you can really go in for the next intake, which is going to be in January or spring session also. Now we go by, if you see, there are many universities who have really extended their application deadlines. You can fill your choice, which was the first before, and now you got the offer from the later on. So you can really go back to the universities, which were your dream ones. You can really fill in their applications now also. There will be some changes, like yes, visa applications will be delayed. There will be changes in visa formalities also. There may be inclusion of a lot of additional documents, like they may require a lot of health checklists from you if you want to apply for a visa for any country. Many universities have now, for this session, made SATs and ACTs optional, which are commonly called as SAT and ACT. GMAT, GRE, and APs have already been delivered at home. You can sit on your computer at home and you can give it to them. Post-study work offers from many, many, many countries have been deferred for the next year. USA, a very important decision has been taken. They have this STEM program option, which is like science, technology, engineering, and mathematic-related courses. These students were automatically get an extension of optional practical training in US. So now there is a possibility that they will not get the extensions, they will not get the this positive decisions on this. DAAD in Germany, which looks after the scholarship for all the students, they have clearly said that there will not be any individual scholarships available for 2020 right now. DASA, which used to be a very important gateway admission for engineering colleges for students who are living abroad, like NRA students in India. Now they will be taking admission on the basis of JEE mains result instead of usual SATs, because this year SAT did not happen. So now they cannot apply it. They cannot send in their scores because they don't have SATs. So they have an option of giving JEE mains, which is supposed to be now in July. So they still have chance. If they want to apply through DASA scheme, they can apply. Now, mostly all the universities, they will have their autumn semesters online. Most of the UK universities have already put it on their FAQ section that October onwards, they will have their online classes. And from November, they are hoping to continue face-to-face classes also. So if we look into the whole situation, you can expect immediate change by moving into face-to-face or slowly, gradually, maybe till the spring session. I've already covered about the extension of the application period, relaxation of some entry requirements, like submission of your scores without giving them actually now. You can give your school reports also later on. They are looking into all the things, especially, you know, parameters to take the admission are not changed. Criteria are same, but they are going to change the way they are looking into now. You have to give one examination on one particular day, and that day is not your day. You're not able to give the examination. So it's not gonna reflect your true ability. Now they are gonna see the holistic profile from the school reports from your class 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th onwards. Like always have been saying from ICS that, you know, don't just focus on your board classes, this 10th and 12th, and ignore your 9th and 11th and just not do very well in those and take it easy. You should, looking into the current situation, you see, you should really focus on having a moving graph or a constant performance for all the academic years of your life. It's not only your one test or one academic thing, it's all your overall profile, including your references from your teachers, any extracurricular activity you've been doing, any community work, any internship have you taken up, any kind of writings you have done. So it's an overall profile. There is a new COVID-19 admission round deadlines, which is a common term coming up in US websites. They used to be round one and round two deadlines. Now they have extended it to a new version called COVID-19 admission round deadlines, where you can easily send your application without any SATs or GREs for the post-graduation. For SATs and ACTs course, you can send it to them now, and they will take it into consideration case-by-case basis. You are most welcome to talk to them on chats, webinars, online sessions. They are ready to help you with your applications. The criteria remains the same, only they are getting more easy on it. Right now, if you want to apply, there are still Australian campuses which have their intake in February. You can still apply to them. Their deadlines are extended till August and September. In UK also, you can have a look on the universities which have the start. The first semester is in February intake. Also, UCAS will be very, by July, they will be opening up for the clearing entry. If you did not get a dream university of your choice, you can still put in your choices by clearing time. The deadline to apply for this is 30 June. If you don't have any of the options of studying abroad right now, or you have offers, and but you have a dilemma whether you should go now because there are a lot of changes, you should focus on your plan B of studying in India. As Dr. Das has already said, it will be very easy for you to settle in, and then you can defer your entry for the next year, or you can go in for a master's course. But what I personally feel is, you should not have a gap period in your profile after giving your class 12. Either you go for a campus now. It's not only applicable to you. It's applicable to the whole world. All the students are on the same profile as you. So even if you're doing your online courses with the university starting with September or October intake, everyone else along with you also is doing the same. So gradually, later on, you'll be moved into your face-to-face and classroom classes, and then you can complete your degree in 3 and 4 years. So there is no point of having a gap period because of this thing. But if you look into the whole matter of financial things and the other conditions, then you can have a plan B of studying in India also. There are universities, there are many cases. A lot of students have been really contacted by the universities directly to talk to them, to send in their profile, to send the papers and send the application, and they are considering, as I told you before, case by case, what they should be giving to your offers with. 2021, the whole international department in all the universities and every country, they are expecting that 2021 will be a whole lot of gain in terms of people. There will be new applications because people will put the plans on hold for this year, so they'll be moving in for next year's. Thus, there will be a lot of deferred entries which will be going in from this year to the next year. So universities are expecting a lot of people joining in 2021. So they'll be gradually increasing the seats also. There'll be a lot of global digital learning collaborative partnerships, which means local institutes in our country, they will have a lot of digital online partnership with maybe LSE and a lot of other campuses abroad. They can digitally deliver in your country. You can sit in your country. You can be enrolled in your college, and you can be having this crossover online certification also sitting in our country to have that abroad degree. Very important is, if you see the education experts, what they say, UCAS on their official statement about the pending admissions for the students, they're saying, don't panic. During this time, it's very important that we are not deciding our admission on the basis of your grades alone. Your personal statement, your interview, your portfolio, your audition, your reference letters, your whole profile from the school is very important to make a decision. Kathleen Gertil, Director of International and Transfer Admission at Miami University, Oxford in OU, is also saying that many US universities are willing to one-to-one with each applicant. We are flexible with deadlines and application materials and any other enrollment deadlines. So you are most welcome to apply. Just bear in mind that what is your goal in life, what you really want to go in for. If you're looking for a professional course and you have really got dynamic offer in your hand, you just go ahead with it. If you're still confused, you can have your plan B option here. Especially class 12 students will face this dilemma, but class 10th and 11th, you have a lot of time to really plan ahead, plan, prepare in advance. And in any of the ways you're doing it, if you have any problems, you can definitely call back. You can email to us. You can contact us. We can just help in planning up all the questions for you.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Kiran Kanjani. That was such a succinct overview of what's happening. And what I got from it is that the universities are much more liberal now, much more accessible, giving you more opportunities than before. So don't worry at all. In fact, if you haven't got your dream campus, write back. We advised a lot of students to write back. And guess what? They engaged with the admission officers and actually got an admission where earlier there'd been a reject. And this includes University of Toronto, it includes Yale, it includes Carleton College. Some of the best have reviewed and given admissions. Now, as Mrs. Kanjani said, going forward, I feel the universities have had an opportunity to relook at the whole admission criteria, and it's going to be much more student-centric and much more compassionate. Right now, there'll be a cutback on scholarships and finances, but later, hopefully it will be restored. So what we are planning to do is that, as so many of you are interested in studies abroad, we'll have a specific session with Mrs. Kanjani and experts from different universities talking to you. You've also asked questions on how to write an essay, statement of purpose, what a letter of recommendation should look like. We'll reply to those individually, but we'll also take up this in a separate session. So if you're interested in a very focused session on studies abroad, please write to us. We'll invite you for a closed group focused session with much more question and answer orientation. Today, we cannot do it because of large numbers. Thank you very much again, Mrs. Kanjani. It was absolutely brilliant. Thank you. Now we move on to top employability skills, which you can develop from now and through college. Data literacy, critical thinking, tech savviness, all of you are. Pick up the latest, adaptability, flexibility, cultural intelligence with global literacy. Emotional intelligence is very important. You know, the head and heart connect, leadership skills, complex problem solving, collaboration, curiosity for lifelong learning, and data literacy. So this is a very important, well-researched bunch of employability skills which you would need to have to succeed no matter what your career. And students start thinking of a career portfolio which will bring together the building blocks of your talents and your interests. And better still, if you need a job, invent it. You can actually shape your job. Companies are going to look at what are your core strengths, competencies, knowledge, and they're going to morph around that. So it's going to be very different now and very exciting. And you can really design a career portfolio which brings together the building blocks of your talents and interests. And it'll be fluid. It'll keep changing. As you journey in life, you will change, the world will change, and you'll get something more coming in. So just remain that veritable explorer and have a blast. Finally, keeping a pandemic like COVID in mind, keeping in mind a very VUCA, volatile, uncertain world, I think is very important for all of us to be able to anticipate what's going to happen next. And this is possible if we are aware of what's happening around us, the news, if we talk to specialists in the field, accordingly prepare, and then get out of our comfort zone to lead the change. It's very important, like this fish, to get out of the water and survive. As I said, survival of the fittest and the quickest. So connect with us. We'll respond to all your queries. Write to us if you want any special programs, especially the next one is going to be studies abroad. So do let us know if you're interested, and we'll organize it very soon for you. We have a website. We are very happy to offer you the password and ID free of cost. So the user ID for you would be ICS Guidance. Password will be ICS Member. We have a big spectrum of careers there. campuses globally, latest cutting-edge information. We also have a website. And our website gives you updates on all admissions, all new courses and scholarships. So do visit website and our Facebook. Facebook is ICS International, Career by Choice, Not Chance. It'll give you updates on a daily basis. We are also just a phone call away, an email away, remain connected. The end of the session should be the beginning of an association. I want to share something great with you. ICS is about to launch a world-class app. This app, within a short duration of 10 minutes, will be your career global positioning system. It will immediately be able to tell you, based on your responses, what your best career fields are, the ideal career fit, and tell you all about the courses and campuses and careers. It'll be mostly free. But if in the end you want specialist guidance, some more tests, you can get in touch with us. Our services are very cost effective because the idea is to launch you as a star in your field. To make sure that you are successful, that you find joy and meaning in your life and live happy lives. So remain in touch with us. And with that, I will close the session today with thanking all our panelists, thanking all of you for being here with us, and continue to send your queries. We will answer each one of them. Thank you, participants. You were absolutely phenomenal. Thank you, Dr. Monika Dass. Thank you, Mrs. Anuja Kumar and Mrs. Kiran Kanjani, for adding so much value through your insights, and Sanchita for getting it all going. And of course, Pooja and Vinit for their support in running this entire program without any problem. Thank you all. Bye for now. Bye.